understand that there's no shortcuts and there's a lot of sacrifices involved in this game that nobody will ever, ever tell you. You're asking for a lot when you want to become, you know, as visible as, you know, some people on this carpet
are, right,
or for that. Yeah, exactly. The right way. It's just be careful. Like, be careful what you wish for.
It's the young girls that are watching that need to see more role models so that they can feel comfortable with making a decision as to, I want to be like her. And what's happening is these particular women are being glorified in these videos. And, you know, young girls don't know any better. They're watching the TV. They see that young girl getting all of the attention because they're not getting it. And I was one of those girls who didn't get attention from my daddy. So now, does that mean attention from any man in any kind of way is good? No.
Welcome back to Hip Hop vs. America, where we're tackling the hip hop debate head on. I'm Jeff Johnson, and we're talking about women and hip hop. Check this out.
Seeing is believing. Seeing is believing.
The only reason I'm in the video is probably because I had a big butt. Of course, it's my butt.
How did we get here?
I don't think it's a bad thing to be in a music video. I love music videos.
From Bubba Sparks' Miss New Booty to 50 Cent's Disco Inferno, it seems like all today's black woman has to offer is a fat ass.
This is a vestige of slavery. The idea that a black woman is there to work, reproduce, and now she's not there to reproduce, but there's still her sexuality for sale.
What used to be confined to pornography is now moving to the mainstream in order to make big money.
I have a good time in a club. Why can't I have a good time in front of the camera? What's the difference?
The art form of dance, of choreography, has gone away. I mean, you might think of a Beyonce video or a Ciara video where you still see, where you feel like, okay, they've done some real choreography here. But a lot of the male-oriented videos, they just up there shaking and acting like they's 2 minutes out of the strip club.
I think what the thing is with black women and how we're sexualized, there's that extra layer of racism there, and there's that extra layer of dehumanization.
You can't stop documenting, or you can't stop doing that because people think that that's wrong. You
know? What's the big deal? It's a video. You don't see white people coming down on white videos when white girls are shaking.
When you have white women who are overly sexualized and that's their only purpose, you can still imagine them in a different form because you can turn the channel and see them doing other things.
Look, if my daughters grow up and they're like, hey, Dad, I'm about to be in Nelly's new video. I'm like, word. So how are you going to be portrayed and understand that this image is going to follow you?
Ultimately, when we look at these images, and when we look at the way that we've allowed it to translate down to our girls, we have to be able to admit, wherever the spiritual lacking is that would allow us to accept that, is problematic.
We certainly need more women who are free, who are critical, who are courageous. Because a lot of this just has to do with people are just too conformist and complacent and too cowardly and just obsessed with making money and fitting in by any means, becoming well adjusted to injustice.
We're about to get right up into this right now. Melissa Ford, you are a former video model, mm-hmm, turned actress, and one of, in many cases, the poster women for what a video girl is. Mm-hmm. What responsibility do rap videos, hip-hop videos have on the negative images of black women?
I mean, the landscape of videos has changed drastically, even since I was a participant in music videos. It was a way to supplement my income in order to pay for my education. I was pursuing higher education. I was in university. So it was just a way to make some extra money. I sacrificed, you know, I made choices. I always understood that it was a choice that I had. Girls didn't aspire to be video models like they do now. Now they don't seem to have goals past becoming a video model because the position has been glorified.
And I'm not going to knock the sacrifice.
Exactly.
But what I'm saying is I want to deal with the product.
The product.
And so I'm not knocking the hustle, The hustle is real, and there are women who are making it work. But
yes, there are.
Product that's being produced, how has that negatively or positively affect the images of black women?
Now it's not just about a girl. It's about body parts. It's about who's got the biggest booty. It really is about who's got the biggest booty now. She's the biggest star. Girls clamor for the camera. They want the most burn. So in order to get that, they're willing to do more salacious things than a girl who's looks at the wardrobe and says, you know, I'm not comfortable wearing that. I'm not comfortable doing that. It's a matter of choice. My moral and value system indicated that I wasn't comfortable doing certain things, whereas another girl was like, hey, whatever, give me the skimpiest thing, point me towards the camera, and I'm gonna make it work for myself. So unless there's people present within your life in order to make you understand that it's fantasy and not reality, it's really going to have a very, very strong effect on you and how you present yourself as a young woman to the world.
Nelly, let me have you chime in there, because I think one of the things that Melissa just talked about is real. There is not an understanding between fantasy and reality. People don't know what happens behind the scenes. How do we as a community deal with that when so many of these young women are wanting to be this because they feel like it's real when it's a game?
I think, again, it goes back to the family. It goes back to the household. It goes back to the father and the mother instilling certain values within the daughter, saying, yo, listen to this. Your body is your best, is your temple. You know, you cherish that. If you want to be respected, you respect yourself first, and then the choices that you choose, you will be judged for later on in life. So I think those are the things that you have to, you know, you have to constantly say that. A lot of girls, like she said again, when she did it to help get her through college. So she had a purpose for doing it. Mm-hmm. You feel what I'm saying? But so you don't know that purpose.
So do we feel like the purpose justifies? Because I know people that, like, I'm selling weed. Selling rocks to go to college.
I mean, life is sacrifice.
No. So hear me out, though.
Right.
So does the means justify the outcome?
I mean, that's not for me to judge, but what I'm saying is that life is sacrifice. Somebody has to sacrifice in order for the next generation to succeed. You can't do everything right for the next generation to come along, then they have nothing to shoot for. If everything is going right for this generation, then what is this generation going to shoot for? It's a building process. We've been set back 400 years. We got a lot of catching up to do, regardless, and a lot of sacrifice must be made in order to catch up. So if this sister has to sacrifice for the next young sister to say, you know what, I appreciate what Melissa did, but I also learned that behind the scenes, Melissa got a lot of things going for her. She started her own company. She started her own business. So now when I go in, I just don't want to be a video vixen. I want to be an entrepreneur who started out doing videos. You see what I'm saying?
So Mike, I want you to hold on to you real quick. I want Mike to come in. Dr. Dyson, excuse me, come in, because you've been sitting more still than I've ever seen you sit, which means you brewing. So chime in on this for me.
Well, look, first of all, you know, we can't pretend that the gluteus emphasis on Maximus has been been articulated first off in hip-hop. I was on the street corners in Detroit. I'm 48 years old. I heard a brother say, girl, you got a great future and it's all behind you. So the reality is that it didn't begin there. But the problem is the reduction of the complexity of black female identity to the gluteus maximus, because what about a brain? What about a heart? What about a soul? We can look at this woman who is ebony ecstasy and furrowed in coffee flesh, and we can see that she's extraordinarily beautiful. But obviously she has a cerebral capacity that is defying what she looks like in terms of stereotypes. But here's the problem. The tragedy is that so many women are reduced to shaking their behinds, their belligerent behinds, or their bouncing bosoms to make a living as a means toward an end, as opposed to in a society where we open up space of opportunity for black women to choose other routes than being a video vixen or employing their bodies as a means toward an end. See, Nelly, as brilliant and good-looking as he is, doesn't have to have only the display of his physical masculinity as a means to achieve his end. So already in a patriarchal box, we're placing women in a narrow framework that only allows them to work that behind toward a higher goal. But the tragedy is that the masses of black women and others are being taught that their bodies are their most important possession. They are temples, but as a means toward an end that they don't always control. And finally, let me say this. The tragedy is that when we look at black America, women are being reduced to their essential physical embodiment, not just in hip-hop. If you look at the church, black women constitute 75 to 80%.
And I want you to stay right there.
And you're watching Black Tree TV.